My name is Clyde Wayne Ottinger, and this is a summary chart of my 55 years of professional experiences. The six categories at the bottom of the chart describe the number of years in the respective specialties, and the combination is particularly unique. This is a pictorial summary showing some of the projects I worked on, starting at the top in 1955 to 1960 on the General Electric J79 engine, and some ejection seat work. The middle row covers 1960 to 1978 and starts with the X-15 rocket research aircraft, then the lunar landing research and training vehicles, and ending with the air cushion vehicles and surface effect ships. The bottom row starts with the uranium enrichment gas centrifuge project and passive solar energy in 1979, and ending in 2002 with my nonprofit work. I started work on the J79 engine in the fall of 1955 at the General Electric Evendale, Ohio plant, working on the preliminary flight rating test engines and performance evaluation and afterburner development. In mid-1956, I started as a flight test engineer at Edwards Air Force Base and worked on the J79s installed in the F-104, the F-11, F-1F, the Regulus II, submarine missile, and as shown here, the B-58 Mach 2 bomber. This picture taken at the SAC Museum in Omaha. The B-58 used three of these crew escape capsules instead of the conventional ejection seats to handle the supersonic envelope. I worked on the components of this capsule in the bomb Convair B seat and sounding rockets in 1959. This in-flight shot of the B-58 shows the four J-79 engine pods, the longer nacelles accommodating the afterburners, and the center pod, which could carry fuel or weapons to match the mission requirements. Starting in 1960, I served as the X-15 propulsion engineer in flight operations at the NASA Flight Research Center, today known as the Dryden Flight Research Center. This poster on the X-15 was released by NASA this year in 2009, and downloadable from the NASA website. It depicts the record set in speed and altitude at the top and the 12 pilots at the bottom. Only four of the pilots are still living today in 2009. This is a picture taken from a chase aircraft soon after launch as the 60,000-pound thrust rocket is providing a 2G acceleration of the 30,000-pound aircraft at launch from the B-52 at 40,000 feet. The 1,000 gallons of liquid oxygen at about minus 370 degrees Fahrenheit and 1,400 gallons of 90% anhydrous ammonia at about minus 48 degrees Fahrenheit were consumed in about 73 seconds as it powered to altitudes as high as 354,200 feet. You can see the frost on the liquid oxygen tank in the bottom center of the aircraft. Here's the X-15 jettisoning propellants to perform an emergency landing at the Nevada Uprange Med Lake bed site, southeast of Tonopah, Nevada. From a launch at 40,000 feet, there is only 3 or 4 minutes to jettison most of the 14,000 pounds of propellants for the landing on the marked runway on the dry lake bed. Out of 10 emergency landings with the three X-15s, only one resulted in a crash, to be shown in a later movie clip. Joe Walker was our chief test pilot and flew the early X-Rocket airplanes as well as the X-15 and made the first flights in the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle. In June of 1966, he was killed in a mid-air collision with his F-104 chase he was flying and the B-70 Mach 3 bomber. Neil Armstrong flew the X-15 prior to going to Houston as an astronaut in September 1962. Neil was also heavily involved in the early Lunar Landing Research Vehicle conceptual development in 1962 while he was still at the Flight Research Center. This clip from the 1961 X-15 movie shows a few of us NASA engineers mixed with the actors in a control room scene. My cigar shows as a stub and was that length before lunch, was told to break the new one in half after lunch for continuity of the shot. Instead, I just sucked it in and got away with it. This fake poster I made for my greats and grands, showing Mary Tyler Moore in her first movie, co-starring with Charles Bronson, and of course, Grandpa is another co-star. This quarter view of the X-15 XLR-99 rocket engine shows the hydrogen peroxide-driven turbopump on the front and the maze of plumbing and control components. A halogen leak tester was used to ensure all liquid and gaseous connections were leak tight. This is a front view of the engine. It was designed for throttling from 50% to 100% of thrust and to be restartable in flight. It was also designed as a man-rated, single malfunction tolerant rocket engine control system. The rocket chamber had an 8.5-inch diameter throat and was made of stainless steel tubing carrying the minus 49 degree liquid ammonia fuel as a coolant. The tubing was coated with a ceramic zirconium oxide, trade name Rockide, applied at the Reaction Motors factory in New Jersey by a rod-fed machine before the injector face was welded to the chamber. As seen at the throat where the highest velocity occurs, serious erosion of the Rockide is evident. So with 8 flight engines supporting 3 airplanes and a year turnaround at the factory for replacement of the Rockide and the loss of Rockide causing tubing leaks of ammonia, I was asked to get a field repair developed. This pantograph machine was designed and built in 2 months of 12 hours, 7 days a week with my NASA team of machinists and fabrication technicians. Its shape matched the chamber contour and kept a plasma arc spray gun using ceramic and metal powders perpendicular to the tubing at all times and was small enough to get through the 8.5-inch chamber throat diameter. The XLR-99 was mounted on a jet engine rollover stand and rotated with a motor-driven system to accommodate the desired spray requirements for the gradated coatings that were being developed, starting with a few mils of pure metal at the tubing wall and progressing through several gradated layers to pure ceramic at the flame front. Various combinations of metal and ceramics were experimental in laboratories, and we took the best for the engine application. After NASA developed this machine, it was turned over to the Air Force Power Plant branch, who maintained the XLR-99 engines, and they further refined the controls to achieve the coating performance required for evenly uniform coating thicknesses. The plasma arc ran at about 20,000 degrees F, and we could turn an engine recoat around in a week compared to a year by the factory rod-fed method. The new field-applied coatings lasted longer than the older Rockide material, and this innovation made a key contribution to the success of the X-15 program. NASA applied for a patent on the pantograph machine we developed. However, in the 1920s, similar machine for coating light bulbs was quoted as prior art. This is a test stand ground run on a flight engine before installation in the aircraft. The propellant system in the test stand is identical to the one in the aircraft. The engines were tested in the aircraft on the opposite side of the same control blockhouse used for the propulsion system test stand, or PSTS, shown in the previous slide. The approximately 6 shock diamonds in the picture represent a Mach number of 6 for exhaust velocity. This was NASA film footage used in the X-15 movie in 1961. The X-15 music used this explosion in the film. It resulted in X-15 number 3 having a 3 failure event during a ground run before it ever flew the first time. The ammonia tank pressure regulator relief valve failed, as well as high back pressure in the ground servicing equipment. Scotty Crossfield, the pilot, was enclosed in the cockpit and uninjured. When the ammonia tank blew, the helium cylinder in the core of the ammonia tank shot into the hydrogen peroxide tank and caused the explosion to sever the airplane in two at the aft edge of the wing. The pilot, safe inside the pressure-sealed cockpit, and the front half of the airplane shot forward as it lost its tie-downs at the back end. This X-15 number 3 was rebuilt with a Honeywell adaptive control system. The upper picture is the number 2 X-15 rebuilt after its crash on Mud Lake. It had drop tanks added to extend the burn time and enables the Mach 6.7 or 4,520 miles per hour speed record, an early prelude to the space shuttle. The lower picture is a model used in the X-15 movie to represent the heating areas on the structure during your reentry. This picture taken from the onboard camera behind the cockpit shows the view from a high altitude flight. Here is a movie clip I made in the 1980s from scraps of old NASA silent films. I narrated a fresh soundtrack for this lecture. The fellow on the left is me with my cigar at the control room console with my boss, the late Perry Rao, a B-17 World War II pilot, a participant in the Palestine oil field bombing raids over Romania.